print. The printer prints out a long text document with dated paragraphs. It looks a bit like someone's journal. Read the printout. The first entry made on the 4th, February 51, by an unknown author is short and concise. Arrived at the church. The door was boarded up, so I used the crowbar to get inside. You were luckier than we were. Looks like the place has been deserted. Nothing out of the ordinary, but I'll ask around. Need to figure out how to get the electricity in. The lieutenant leans closer, scouring the printout over your shoulder. Just as you finish reading, he looks up, muttering under his breath. 4th of February. That's over a month ago. Whoever set those machines, who set up those machines, has been here for quite a while. Do you think this log might be connected to the case? Our case? No, I don't think so. It must be some local... His eyes wander to the various machines around him. Eccentric. Read the second entry. 6th, February 51. Had a little chat with the local fisherman. Said I shouldn't go near that place. Said the church was spooky and ridden with narcotics. It's a little spooky, all right. Still haven't figured out the electricity. Read the third entry. 7th, February 51. Finally got the electricity in. Next on the agenda, a new antenna. I'm thinking Esker series? Something advanced. Why would she need an antenna? Kim says, why would anyone need any of this equipment here? He steps on a wire running on the ground, inspecting it with his boot. Read the fourth entry. 8th, February 51. Bought the antenna. Had some problems setting it up. Called Simo for help. Heard the others are back to making art. Drinking somewhere out of town. Sulis Law started a rock band again. Lexi has been seen asking money from strangers. But at least the artists have their act together. They're qualified labor. They can get work anywhere. Graphic design, ads. The programmers are doing fine, too. I mean, they're programmers. The writers, though, they're screwed. Is she looking for a place for these people to live or something? To set up a studio? For artists? Graphic programmers and writers? Are they going to set up a game studio here or something? I just have to find out what caused that data loss and be done with it. Still don't understand how it managed to wipe out the backup when the backup wasn't even connected to the front. I know. Everyone thinks it's impossible. They say I must be lying. I'm here to set it right. A data loss? Kim says, seems like something to do with radio computers. Unfortunately, I don't know enough about them to understand what the author is saying. Something about backup data getting destroyed, and how everyone thought it was the author's fault. He adjusts his glasses. Let's just keep reading. I don't know. I think they're looking for a new studio for them. These people can find work somewhere else. Where they were, the studio they were at burned down or something like that. The programmers can find work anywhere, and the artists can do graphic design and ads for other companies. But the writers are screwed. I guess people don't want writers. Yeah, artists, programmers, Lexi. Who are all these people? Her friends? Colleagues? He shrugs. She must be quite educated if she knew how to set up all this machinery. Read the fifth entry. 12th, February 51. Bought some food from the grocery store. Apparently there's a strike going on in the harbor. Definitely not happy to see the Martinez people again. Everything's now set up in the church. Going to start working tomorrow, 8 a.m. What day is today? The strike. He strokes his chin. We're nearing the date of the murder. Okay. So it's not your current day. Keep reading. I'm interested now. I want to know what that radio anomaly that sent this... What's that radio anomaly that sent this person here in the first place? Read the sixth entry. Oh, we skipped ahead here, didn't we? February 25th now. 25th, February 51. I've been sending data up to Lintel for a while now, trying to recreate the data loss, but nothing. Didn't even feel like logging into disappointment. But I did discover a curious audio spatial anomaly at the back of the church. I've named it the Swallow. It's Swallow Sound. Need to get some mics. Yeah, we've seen that. Is she talking about... The lieutenant looks to his right, toward the silence. Yes, she is. Read the 7th entry. 28th February, 51. Yes, the first recordings confirm that the swallow is real, and I'm not just losing my mind. It's a pillar of silence with a diameter of approximately 3 meters. Seems the higher I go, the less I record. This might be a coincidence, or it could be connected to the data loss that led me here. The pillar of silence. She is talking about the silence. Is she suggesting it's more than just an architectural quirk? But what could it be? Look at the water basins behind us. The lieutenant doesn't answer. He follows your gaze, studying the basins. The water shines in them. No ripples. Read the 8th entry. March, 51. Some kind of young disco men have appeared next to the church. I've been trying to record the silence to find the epicenter, but now it turns out I've also been capturing the future of dance music. One neo-disco song over and over again. Oh yeah, because he plays the same song for like a month. Fortunately, the song is so monotonous I was able to devise an algorithm to factor it out. The other day, one of the disco men came in. Before I could even say hello, she got scared and left. Good. I don't want anyone distracting me from my work. She was looking at our friend over there, not you. Reaction speed says, that disco man must be a cell. She must be describing a cell. The girl on the ice? Kim says. Sounds like her, yes. Read the 9th entry. March 51. A new 2mm auxiliary cable, noodles, crackers, ping-ping energy drinks, water, toothpaste, gum, also some canned air. Your reading is interrupted by the sound of the church door opening, Perception says. Oh, she is spooky, and that sound was spooky. A strange woman makes straight from the radio computer, Soona, the programmer. Hi? Must have set off a silent alarm for her. Not reacting to us yet, just typing on the computer. Maybe she doesn't realize I'm holding out a printout of her journal. Was that the last page?
Breaking into my radio computer, I see.
Oh no, she saw us. She glares at you as she holds down the off button for several seconds. The machine reboots. It's okay, we printed out your whole journal anyway. Interfacing says, yes, you are breaking in, but not into her radio computer. You're a master circuit bender.
I do apologize for the intrusion, madame. We are with the RCM, you see.
I can assure you I'm an expert circuit bender. I'm not breaking into your computer. I'm using it to access coalition military data links.
There are no coalition military data links. And even if there was, you couldn't access them over a civilian network.
She barely looks up from her keyboard. Yes, I could. I'm a cybernetic god. I'm using your RAM project to commandeer the coalition warship Archer. I will turn its cannons against its masters.
That's nonsense. You're just a police officer.
Oh well, it was worth a try. She barely looks up from the keyboard. You hear the machine whir back to life.
Now, please give me some room. I need 2 seconds to see that you haven't destroyed anything.
Okay, we'll be counting.
We should talk to her after she has rebooted the machine.
Can't talk to her yet.
What is it?
The woman is still hunched over the keyboard, gently illuminated by the purring machine. Sorry, but who are you? What are you doing here?
I am Soona Lukanen Hilde, the former lead programmer of Fortress Accident and RSA radios.
Oh.
I have over 16 years of programming experience, and I'm proficient in both Vox and Orbis languages.
What is that Orbis language again?
If you're not here to hire me, I don't really know how can I help you.
She turns back to the terminal. Logic says, did she say over 16 years of experience? She must have started programming when she was still a teenager. Why are there so many machines in this place? I brought them here. These are my machines. Please don't touch anything. Why do you need an antenna? I use the AR-1 as my REM prefix processing unit. REM prefect, that's your radio computer, right? Mm-hmm. And that antenna is its processing unit? Yes. You really don't know anything about radio computers, do you? She has stopped working now. I know a little. Alright, well, all radio computers perform operations up on air, so in order to gain more processing power, you need to invest in a good antenna. Wait, what's on air? On the front, the unified front of radio waves, licensed and controlled by Lintel in the East Insulindic region. It's all around us. She raises her hand. That's what on air means. Conceptualization says, like love. And the AR-1, is it a good antenna? She stops to think. I guess it is. So far I've been quite satisfied with it. Martinez is an unstable region with bad coverage, and the operation has been surprisingly stable. But it's not the cheapest one on the market, so I wouldn't recommend it for your regular red tape operations. Fraser 1000 is a foolproof line for civilians. Anyway, she turns back to her terminal. You should do some research before you decide to buy anything. Ask around, compare the prices. There are many milieus dedicated to that sort of thing. Hey, no said about me buying anything. Empathy says she liked telling you this. It calmed her nerves. Yeah, I was wondering why she's... We're breaking into her computer and she's like... all full of useful information. What are you doing with your radio computer? I'm working. Working on what? Could you... She closes her eyes. Could you just shush for a moment? I'll get to the point. I really need to focus on something. What about those bowls of water over there? They are connected to my REM prefect. She looks up. Whatever you do, just please do not move them, okay? Thanks. Rhetoric says, short and terse. There you have it. Whatever she's using them for, they're hers. Isn't your REM prefect radio computer made exclusively for the government use? So you do know something about computers. She looks up, almost proud of you. You're right. Prefect is used mostly by the government peeps. And you work for the government? No, I don't. So then why do you have it? She inhales sharply before answering in a single breath. Because I needed something good for my investigation, and REM Civic is widely agreed to be below all standards, so I had to upgrade. Besides, owning a REM prefect isn't such a big deal anymore. Interfacing says, no, actually, it is kind of a big deal. You don't see REM prefects in every police department, for example. How did you get your hands on it? I know a friend of a friend who used to freelance for the Coalition. She says nonchalantly, scratching her ear. I was actually aiming for the military-grade REM Rational series, but couldn't find one. She pats her glowing machine. Prefect is mainly based on the same technology as REM Civic, so it's kind of a rip-off, but it does have better compatibility with newer antenna models, so I won't complain. Well, next question. Great. She dwells back into her glowing terminal. Have you seen the Crab Man? No. But you know he's around? Yes. It sounds like you're not worried about him at all. No, you're right. I'm not. Her voice trails off as she bends over to tinker with the machine's printer. What are you doing in an abandoned church? You really like those questions, don't you? There's a hint of amusement in her tired eyes. You're occupying a public space. I need to know what you're doing here. I am conducting a scientific research here. You can't throw me out. She stands ready to stand her ground. She says, right, waiting to stand her ground. What research? I'm looking for the location of a two millimeter hole in the world. What? Logic says, wait, what? Interfacing says she's looking for a disruption in the radio waves. That's what her personal log said. The lieutenant raises his brows, but doesn't say anything. A hole in the world? What does that mean exactly? Exactly what does it mean? There's something frantic about her as she locks her gaze upon you, eyes shining like pearls. Up to now it's been impossible to say what it is because it's impossible to measure nothing. What do you think it is? What qualities does nothing have? How do you measure something that does not exist? She's suddenly absorbed in the conversation, waiting for your answer. Logic says, that's a little above your pay grade at the moment. Logic, you're awesome sometimes. Hold on a moment. Does it mean we're now living in a world that has holes in it? I don't know. Are we? That's what I'm trying to figure out here. But how do I figure it out? I can't even understand how we're talking about something that doesn't exist, let alone measure it. You measure it by its surroundings, by that which does exist, she replies, which is what I have been trying to do. I've tried using hypertransducers to record the silence to find out where it begins. Ha! Encyclopedia says, hydrotransducers. So that's what those water basins are. Devices for recording sound through water. But honestly, it's not progressing very well. She goes silent, staring at her circle of basins. It looks like some ancient ritual. Do you have any idea where this hole might be located? Somewhere underneath those roof beams, I assume. She looks up, eyes trying to pierce the pitch-black heights above, but without much success. Why there? There's this place at the back of the church, a place where all audible vibrations seem to decease. I've named it the Swallow, and the higher you go, the less you record. The Pillar of Silence, Kim says. Are you sure it's not just an architectural quirk? Maybe, but it's oddly close to the physical coordinates of the data loss which led me to this place. This is where the Crabman lives. I know. You don't think Crabman might be somehow responsible here? No, I don't. Empathy says she sounds mildly annoyed by this line of questioning, her hands typing hundreds of commands into the machine. Is the hole connected to the data loss in your journal? Yes, that's what led me here. She stares at the burnished antenna on a nearby table, but I suspect it might be something a bit more complicated than that. You said that the research isn't going well. Why not? Because it's just trial and error, trying to locate the Swallow, the exact point in space. And I don't have a... She stops mid-sentence. You know what? It would be really helpful if you could just stop talking and let me work. Okay, well that's all I wanted to know about the scary 2-millimeter hole in the world, for now. Great. Her hands are a whirl on the keyboard. Thanks. Well... I'm going to bother you one more time. How do you feel about Anadic dance music? What? She squints her eyes. I hate it. Conceptualization says, I bet she hasn't even heard it. Have you even listened to it? Like, actually listened? Yeah, like all the time. My tent neighbors don't really ease up with their partying, do they? She pulls a face that looks absolutely scathing. Maybe I have to be on drugs to get it, but to a sober mind it just sounds like uninspired rug-whipping. No idea what it has to do with either dancing or music. Right, but how do you feel about a club for Anadic dance music? This is about those speed freaks in a tent, isn't it? She looks up, shaking her head. I've got some news for you. It's not a nightclub they want to build here. What do they want to build, then? Take a guess, why don't you? A youth center would be nice. The lead programmer sighs. I can't believe they got you so easily. Go have another talk with those up-and-coming entrepreneurs, will you? Thanks. Good luck, the lieutenant nods. I'm not coming in there. Alright, I'll let you work in peace now. Tell Andre about Soona's thoughts on the nightclub. Do I still have this journal? That's my badge. Did I ever look at this thing? Yeah, I did. Wait, if that's my ledger... What's a fuel canister? Yeah, I guess I don't actually have this thing. Okay, so now finally... What about this? In white, silver, and apricot faience, the young mother of humanism stands above you. Oh, I see. I like that. A crack runs across her body. She is impossibly tall, oval-faced, and sad. A dark and radiant majesty. Encyclopedia says, this is her innocence, Dolores Dei. Cradled in her arms are a pair of glowing lungs, clearly visible from underneath her flowing dress. Oh, look, the lungs on that guy's belt. You should kneel. Kneel. Your knees touch the floor. The floorboards are hard and cold. There you kneel among the snowdrifts, diffused light falling on your hands from beyond the glass. Close your eyes first. The world is silent, but for the creaks and cracks of the massive wooden structure behind you, it covers you from the wind outside. The woman looks down at you kneeling. She towers among her followers, architects, laymen, courtiers. There is a sad smile on her lips and a glint in her green-blue eye. Of what? Compassion? Remorse? Conceptualization says she acknowledges the passing of someone who is still alive. Empathy says you. It's compassion. As that soft word passes through your mind, the lieutenant draws an X-shaped cross from shoulder to shoulder. Do the same as I get up. Your fingertips touch your chest four times, then you rise from your knees into the apricot-colored light of the window. Above you, the woman still smiles her distant smile, sundered by the crack in the glass. This is Dolores Dei. The old woman in the village was right, he looks around. This must be the Delorean Church of Humanity in Martinez, or the small Pinewood Church in some records. You knew of the place? It's a minor landmark, not easy to find. Most maps misplace it. He lowers his voice. It was built not long ago after Revachol's founding, 300 or so years ago, by first-generation settlers. Encyclopedia says, on the coast of an uninhabited archipelago, where only animals had roamed before, in the wild reeds. What else do you know? There used to be seven staved churches on the coast, Les Sept Sœurs, they called them, the Seven Sisters. Only one remains. The rest were burnt in the Revolution, or used for building materials. We should be respectful here, although the building appears to be deserted. I do not believe we'll find anything connected to the lynching here. Something else, perhaps. He looks at the machinery lying around. Conceptualization says respectful. Is the lieutenant a follower of Delorianism? Empathy says there it is again. A small pang of guilt. It's time to ask him what happened here. Do you know why it was abandoned? I have a theory, yes. There's a pause, then he continues. There was a police raid a while back. I heard the place was shot to pieces. The old woman in the village was being tactful with us when she didn't mention it. She has more respect for the RCM than many around here. Who conducted this raid? Well, your station was involved, I hear, although I can't be sure. Rhetoric says, how come a lieutenant isn't sure? Is this confidential information? You're not sure? Three precincts were involved in the raid, and people say Precinct 41 was one of them. I don't remember being here, but that doesn't mean much. I am pretty sure it was a clandestine operation. I don't know anything more about it, why it was conducted, or who participated. I try not to pry into extra-district matters. If I was here, I should find out what I was doing. Good luck. You will not get information on a confidential operation from your station secretary just by calling. If you really don't remember, it might be better to keep this one forgotten. It happened a while ago. It's unimportant to our business in Martinez now. Kim, are you a follower of Delorianism? Yes, we all are. Her name, body, and rule are synonymous with humanism. The laws we enforce are Dolorian in origin. I didn't think you were spiritual. It's not spiritual, it's constitutional. The Dolorian system does not demand faith, only accordance. Encyclopedia. How did I know this is the mother of humanism? Success. Despite the damage you've done to yourself, the title appears lodged in your hippocampus. This is her innocence, Dolores Dei, the innocence of humanism, internationalism, and the welfare state, perhaps the most famous human being ever to have lived. No amount of Commodore Red can wipe her sad smile from your brain thing. It has survived the deluge and haunts you still, and will haunt you forever as it haunts all men. What else do I know about her? Many things. You know she was a woman of the court, the wife of an influential Marchese, and eventually the principal advisor to Irene la Navigateur, Queen of Serene, modern-day Sur-la-Clef. Also that she was gorgeous beyond beauty. Okay, what else? Was she smart? Terribly. Women of the court were expected to play both contract, bridge, and chess sufficiently well to prove an interesting challenge to a man. A similar grasp in matters of philosophy, theology, and science was encouraged. She was, by all means, a kept woman. She made the most of her position in the Antedolorian court, a court visited by the most prominent thinkers and artists of the day. In secret, she was becoming the era's preeminent philosopher of the state, a scalpel, a piercing gaze. She was an almost preternaturally magnetic and intelligent individual. To her contemporaries, she appeared out of time, a messenger from the future of the species. We all fell in love with her, head over heels. Even before she was declared an innocence, her influence was tremendous. How come? It was on her advice that Irene la Navigateur sponsored a number of voyages into the Pale, a costly, often tragic endeavor, ultimately vindicated by the discovery of the new world, the piece of reality you're standing on. She was crowned 2 years after the first expedition returned, setting in motion what is widely considered the greatest era in history, the Dolorian era. Wow. Wow indeed. When her innocence was declared, and the queen she had advised for years fell on her knees before her, she was so overcome with emotion that her lungs started glowing in her chest. Bystanders reported golden filaments lighting the already sunlit chamber around her, clearly visible beneath her dress. What? Conceptualization says this is why the lungs are the symbol of love for the cultures of the Real Belt. Right, and it was on Egghead's belt. His actual belt. You know, not the belt geographically speaking, but the belt that was around his pants. Wait, what exactly is an innocence? I've heard of the system. The highest category of historic individual, an embodiment of the world's spirit. A ruler? More, an innocence is elected to office by the founding party, a precedent that has taken place a mere 6 times in the entirety of history. The legal system of the Real Belt is built to accommodate is a centric rule, should it coincide with our time. An innocence is infallible. The decisions made by one are not decisions, they're inevitabilities, which would have happened anyway, only accelerated, packed into decades instead of centuries. An innocence is a continuous, compressed event, a sacred human being, is an honor and a glory to live when one is in office. Is one in office now? No, we are alone. Okay, when did she rule? 300 years ago, in the wake of the discovery of this Isola, the Insulindian, by explorers from the continent of Mundi, she is, among other things, the innocence of intersolary travel and the connected world. Was there something terrifying about her? Terrifying is a term too emotionally charged for your semantic memory, or what remains of it. But, although she is often considered to be the greatest human being to ever live, there was something ominous about Dolores Dei. Constantly surrounded by her theriers, she was the most socially secluded and least self-aware of all the innocences. Some modern thinkers would consider her a war criminal for the campaigns she waged against the Mesk state, and then there were the resettlement programs. What happened? My, there's a lot of stuff here. The Mesk state tried to detach itself from innocentic rule. Parts of the world were experiencing whiplash from accelerating into secularism. Her mandatory education programs and mass resettlement of upstream migrant were problematic as well. Dissenters were suppressed by a military force she called the Army of Humanity. Rhetoric says, suggesting those who fight against it are not part of humanity. She adored chess, yes, but also military war games. Dolores Dei often holds a tiny tin soldier between her index finger and thumb, in icons such as this. She was also blonde, the blondest woman you have ever seen, with green eyes the color of the Cyantric Mare Interregnum. Little is known of her Marchese husband. It's as if he vanished from history after completing his role, which was to introduce Dolores Dei to court. In conclusion, yes, there is something lonely, paranoid, and even terrifying when people seldom mention, but feel, what they think of her. When they think of her. Conceptualization says the subtle terror is part of her iconography. Kim says, Lieutenant Yefreder, you've stood there for over 5 minutes. Lieutenant's calm voice echoes in the cold air of the church. Sorry, I was talking to my encyclopedia part of my brain. Don't tell me you've never done that. What are you thinking of, if I may ask? She's beautiful. That she is, a great sacral piece. I wonder what we're doing here, however. He takes his glasses off to clean them. In this church, I mean. The coast, in general. We shouldn't linger. This isn't a good place to get lost in. I can try to do this. Visual calculus. Try to reconstruct the cracked glass. Success. Oh my god, we put it back together. That's amazing. I feel like very proud of myself. Way to go, Harry. A jigsaw of broken shards falls into place in front of you. A ghostly reconstruction of the stained glass window. How do I even do that? How can I even reach up there? Or is this just in my mind I'm seeing it? Probably. Before it was shattered, there was an older woman beneath the younger one, and a text, elite motif, below them both. What shattered this mosaic? Visual calculus says, unknown. Logic says, something during the raid the lieutenant mentioned, or just hooligans looking for something to break. Who is the older woman? She has glasses on? Or goggles? The escutcheon, have you say that? On her throne says, Irene the Navigator. Oh, the Navigateur? She is depicted as an older woman wearing thick-rimmed eyeglasses holding a golden Reichsapfel. That looks like German. In one hand and a scepter in the other. This is the queen her Innocence Day advised. Above she herself is whole. Small figures of wise men, common men, worshippers walk up the stairs to stand at her feet. Secret servicemen, Theriers, stand in a row guarding her. It must have taken years to produce this work in all its dizzying detail. The motto, what does it say? Visual calculus says, below both women, in luminous black letter, Après la vie, mort. Après la mort, la vie de nouveau. And then, along the left side, Après le monde, la gris. Après la gris, le monde de nouveau. Okay, I'm glad I'm here, because I didn't want to look described from French, it looks like this. Translate on my phone. After life, death. After death, life again. After the world, the pale. After the pale, the world again. We keep hearing about this pale, but not much about it. Just keep mentioning it. This is the great leitmotif of humanism, a summary of the effect of the discovery of this Isola, the Insulindian, on human thinking, a tremendous sea change akin to finding life after death. Lieutenant, this used to say after life, death, after death, life again, he nods. After the world, the pale, after the pale, the world again. This exaltation is common in Delorium sacralism. In the early years, it was even incorporated as the RCM slogan. No more, however. Why? It was deemed subservient, to use a strongly moral intern-related motto. Where already suspected of bootlicking, the sentence was also seen as too feminine. It was a macho thing. What is the RCM motto now? Justice, union, prudence, and force. Huh. I like the other one better. So do I. The mother of humanism towers above you, a wax painting on a cracked pane of glass. Nothing has changed in her expression. Our friend is gone, right? Yeah, alright. Should I ask her what she thinks about all this? Will she answer?
Yes, what is it?
No, okay. I should think I'm going to do that next episode. We're going to return to the hardcore people over on the ice. And ask him about, what's Soona? What's her name? Tell Andrea about Soona's thoughts on the nightclub. Maybe they'll give me more information about the signs. About her associates. But in any case, that'll be next episode, at the very soonest, because this is the end of this one. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time, and always seek adventure.